Most missing person cases are relatively simple and solved within a few days, if not sooner. More mysterious missing person cases can go unexplained for years or even decades. Number 5. On the surface, the missing person case of Luc Jolly de Rocher is relatively simple, though tragic. He disappeared while intoxicated, not too far from a body of water. In most cases, this would be an open and shut case, even if a body was never found. But police believe that there was more to it than that, and this case only gets more mysterious. Luc was 20 years old when he went missing on a night out in March of 2011. He was staying with a friend in North Bay, Ontario. The nearby Lake Nipissing was frozen at the time, and a snowstorm was due. Luc and his friends spent the evening of March 4th drinking, and by the time they decided to go out, Luc was intoxicated. The group traveled to a bar about 10 minutes away, arriving just before midnight. Luc was barred entry, but his friends went inside. It was the last time that they would see him. Rather than head back to where he was staying, Luc wandered along Main Street. He was seen on security footage entering a Bank of Montreal location, followed by an unidentified man. However, he didn't withdraw any money at the time. His bank card would be found a few days later in the snow, and it seemed like he had dropped it at some point between leaving the house and arriving at the club. For years, that was thought to be the last place Luc was spotted, leaving open the possibility that he had fallen into the lake. Even though it was frozen over at the time, there was a possibility he might have broken through the ice. Numerous searches of the water turned up nothing, and police were still following up other leads. There was a great deal of attention on the unidentified man who followed Luc into the bank, and some believe he may have been involved in the disappearance. In 2019, police announced there was a later sighting of Luc. He was seen by employees at Shooter's Bar at the Voyager Inn, a 30-minute walk from the bank where he had been caught on CCTV. According to witnesses there, he'd left at about 3:30 a.m., having obtained a ride from a customer there. For some reason, police believe Luc met with foul play. The second location was some distance from a significant body of water, making an accident less likely. Luc's father believed that he owed someone money, and they had attacked him when he was unable to withdraw the money at the bank. Though that wouldn't explain the later sighting. Another theory is that he met someone unsavory while hitchhiking home. It's likely someone knows what happened to Luc. He is described as having a slim build, standing 5'8" tall, and weighing 150 pounds at the time of his disappearance. He was wearing a dark navy jacket, gray t-shirt, and dark blue jeans. Any information should be passed on to North Bay Police Service or Near North Crime Stoppers. Number 4. On July 16, 1996, Susan Walsh dropped her 12-year-old son off with her estranged husband. She said she would be gone for half an hour, and she was going to run errands and make a call at the phone box down the street. She never came back. Susan was a freelance journalist. She had a history of alcohol and substance use when she was at college, but had gotten herself clean after she graduated. She had also worked as an exotic dancer, which gave her a unique perspective that helped her journalistic career. Her big break came when she wrote a story for the magazine Village Voice about the Russian mob, exposing illegal acts in some New Jersey strip clubs. Naturally, writing about a criminal organization earned her some enemies, and she received some threats. But at the time, it didn't seem like she was in any danger. In 1987, she married Mark Walsh, a musician, and they had a son together the following year. But by the early 1990s, their marriage had begun to deteriorate, and they split up for good. Mark moved into the basement flat of the building Susan lived in. By 1996, Susan's life had become messy again. After 12 years clean, she had started drinking again, stopped taking her bipolar medication, and was taking anxiety medication. She was also working in a strip club again. But she was also doing a lot of work in her journalism career, and had done research for a book on the sex industry by James Ridgway and Sylvia Plachy, and had appeared in a documentary about strippers created by her friend Jill Morley. She had found her passion in speaking up for women who were in this line of work. Everything then came to a halt on that July day. Police would later discover no outgoing calls were made at any nearby payphones. At first, Mark wouldn't let police into the house, but they eventually came in and discovered the entire month of July had been ripped from Susan's calendar, possibly to hide some appointment that she had that day. What happened to Susan remains a mystery. She was suffering from mental problems at the time, so some believe she may have taken her own life. Others suspect foul play, as they couldn't see her doing that to her son. She had believed she was being stalked shortly before she disappeared, and some believe the Russian mob was after her. The strangest theory is that her disappearance was due to a vampire cult. She had been researching real-life vampires shortly before she vanished. It was a strange subculture she was very interested in, and she even dated someone who claimed to be a vampire for a short time. Susan was apparently upset when the magazine she worked with rejected her article on the cult. Some suspect just writing about them might have angered members of this group, even though nothing was published. There was a sighting of Susan some months after she vanished. A friend allegedly saw Susan get into a black car with a man. The man was tracked down, but he couldn't be certain the woman he was with was actually Susan. If Susan is alive today, she would be 61 years old. At the time of her disappearance, she was 5'6" tall, weighing 110 pounds, and had bleached blonde hair. Information on the case should be passed to the Nutley Police Department or New Jersey State Police. Number 3. Most missing person cases don't get a large amount of media attention, even those that have been cold for decades, leaving the family and law enforcement puzzled as to what had happened. This is the case with Carla Elizabeth Losey, who's been missing since 2002. Not a lot of information has been released about Carla's life, and even less is known about her disappearance. She was 20 years old when she disappeared, living in Columbus, Ohio. She had family in the area and was close to her mother and sister. She was living at the 40 West Motel and worked as an exotic dancer at a number of bars. According to the Charlie Project, Carla had previously been arrested for prostitution, but it's not known if this was something Carla was involved with at the time of her disappearance. It was New Year's Eve when she was last seen. Like any bar, El Grotto's, where Carla worked, would have been expecting a large crowd of people to bring in the new year. Carla left her home at 7 p.m. to go to the bar, where she remained until about midnight. She was last seen by witnesses leaving the bar shortly after midnight. She was with an unidentified African-American man. No CCTV footage of Carla leaving has ever been made public. This was where the trail went cold. What happened to Carla after that remains a mystery. She may have attempted to travel to Richmond, Virginia, or New York by public transport, or hitchhiking, but nobody has ever come forward to say they saw her. Her family believe she may have passed away, but still have not given up hope that they might find her and get the answers they deserve. Carla was 5'6" tall and weighed 135 pounds when she disappeared. She was wearing a black dress when she left the bar. She was Caucasian and of Yugoslavian descent, but could have been mistaken for Latina. She would be 39 years old if she were still alive today. Number 2. When one person or even a small group of people go missing without a trace, it can be disturbing. But when an entire plane disappears, leaving behind no clues as to how or why something like this would happen, it's particularly creepy. The plane in question was a Boeing 727 with the tail number N844AA. its time in Angola had been nothing but trouble. The plane was owned by Aerospace Sales and Leasing, and had been taken to Angola by a company looking to take advantage of the civil war there. The plan was to use the plane to bring fuel to the diamond mines there, but between disputes with local partners and the volatile nature of the situation in Angola, the deal fell through. Now Aerospace Sales and Leasing were repossessing the plane. That was where Ben Padilla came in. Ben was a Florida-based flight engineer who had been traveling around the world for work. He had a private pilot's license and couldn't fly the plane himself. But when Ben arrived in Angola to work on the plane in November of 2002, it was in no condition to be flying anywhere. Ben's job was to get it ready to be flown to South Africa, where there was a new buyer who wanted it for its engine. Ben had hired a man named John Mutantu from the Republic of the Congo as a helper and had arranged with a local flight crew to fly the plane to South Africa when it was ready. Progress was going well until May 25th of 2003. At around 6 p.m. local time, Ben and John boarded the 727. Onlookers were amazed when the plane began taxiing for takeoff. The tower at the airport was unable to get a response from the 727, as it took off without permission, leaving behind the flight crew that were supposed to be on board. Mari Joseph, president of the company that owned the plane, was notified of its disappearance by the Angolan flight crew. He contacted the U.S. Embassy in South Africa and asked his wife back in the U.S. to contact the FBI. International alerts were issued to try to locate the 727. It shouldn't have been able to fly with just two people on board, even if both of them were qualified, which wasn't the case. There was fear that someone else had been on board and had hijacked the plane with the intention of crashing it, but there was no such act. The 727 disappeared without a trace. It's likely if the plane was hijacked, it crashed into the ocean somewhere and hasn't been recovered. Alternatively, it might have been taken over by smugglers. A burned-out 727 was discovered in the Sahara Desert in November of 2009. It was determined that the plane had landed safely, its cargo had been unloaded, and the plane had then been set ablaze. There have been other alleged sightings of the plane, but none have ever been confirmed as the missing N844AA. There have been no such sightings of Ben and John. Even if the missing plane is found, there's a chance this mysterious missing person case won't be solved. Number 1. The disappearance of Brandon Lawson is one of the most mysterious, unexplained missing person cases. It's been more than 8 years since he vanished in Texas, and his family are no closer to finding the answers they need for closure. Brandon was 26 years old at the time of his disappearance. He was an oil field worker, which resulted in long hours and put a strain on his relationship with his fiancée, Ladessa. But in August of 2013, Brandon was looking forward to starting a new job, which should have left him with more time to spend with Ladessa and his four young children. But Brandon was also dealing with other issues. He had a history of using illegal substances, and though he had been clean for about 6 months, he had recently started using again. On August 8, 2013, Brandon and Ladessa got into an argument about Brandon's relapse, as he'd been trying to get substances from his brother Kyle earlier that day. According to Ladessa, Brandon was tripping and started flipping out. He left the house just before midnight and started the 3-hour drive to his father's house in Fort Worth, Texas. At around 12:30 a.m., he called Kyle. He had run out of gas on Highway 277 and needed Kyle to bring some. However, Kyle was waiting to get paid, so he decided to go where Brandon said he was, get money, and then go get gas. Kyle drove to where Brandon said he would be. His girlfriend and their young son were in the car with him. When they arrived, there was no sign of Brian. His truck was there, parked erratically at the side of the road. The doors were all open, and Brandon's keys, phone, and wallet were missing. Kyle called Brandon again, but the signal was very bad, and Kyle couldn't make out what he was saying. When Kyle asked where Brandon was, he said he was right there. While they were talking on the phone, a police officer pulled up. Brandon told Kyle, one time, run, which Kyle later said referred to law enforcement. Kyle told Brandon he wasn't going to run, as he hadn't done anything wrong. Brandon asked him where his pride was and hung up. The police officer informed Kyle a trucker had reported Brandon's abandoned car, as it was parked dangerously. For the next 4 hours or so, Kyle drove up and down the road looking for his brother, but there was no sign of him. Ledessa filed a missing person report the following morning, and while she was going through Brandon's phone records, she discovered he had called 911 after asking Kyle to bring him gas. The call has been released to the public. In it, Brandon sounded panicked and described someone chasing him. It's hard to make out what he's saying, but it sounded like he believed he was surrounded. He also said repeatedly that he ran into them and asked for police to come. There were also loud bangs heard in the background, which some have interpreted as a weapon being used, but Kyle said it was the sound of vehicles going over a nearby bridge. Extensive searches of the area where Brandon's vehicle was abandoned have taken place. At one point, police believe they found the spot where Brandon had been watching Kyle, but none of his belongings were ever recovered. Today, there are numerous theories about what happened in this missing person's case. Given the 911 call, some people believe Brandon stumbled across something he shouldn't have, and have even suggested rogue police officers were doing something illegal. Although if this was the case, calling 911 doesn't make sense. Others have suggested he intentionally vanished, as he had a bench warrant. But again, if he was running from police, calling them wouldn't make sense. A more likely theory is that Brandon was simply under the influence of illegal substances, and succumbed to the elements while on a bad trip. If this is the case, the numerous searches would have overlooked his body, but answers could be found with enough searching. Brandon was 5'9" and weighed 230 pounds at the time of his disappearance. He was wearing a yellow shirt and camouflage shorts. Anyone with information on this missing persons case should contact the Texas Department of Public Safety. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you liked this video, be sure to hit that like button. Also, don't forget to subscribe and click that notification bell to keep up to date with all of our future uploads. But I've been Ty Knotts, and I'll catch you guys in the next video.